Welcome to the session with Dr. Thomas Dykstra.
That is so dramatic.
How did it sound?
It actually sounded pretty good. I think it was a good beginning.
I don't have to redo it?
No. I think we should go with that one.
The doctor of sugar, the sugar daddy of plants, the measurement of carbon, oxygen, hydrogen, the simple sugar form.
You are still on fire.
The one, the only, Dr. Thomas Dykstra. And the crowd goes crazy. Okay, here we go.
I don't hear any crowd.
No tillers. Take a breath. We've been getting requests from the gals on the phone. That we're getting a lot of calls that people say, well, I'm no-till because I don't want to kill, destroy, decapitate, mutilate the mycorrhizal fungi in my soil. Now, if you're growing a perennial tree crop,
perfectly okay, because during the growth of the tree, the fungal ratios increase over bacteria. So the fungal bacterial ratios increase. This is well established. It's been looked at. A number of people have looked into it. I think it's an established phenomenon, and we don't want to downplay the importance of fungi, especially when you're dealing with the trees. And these are the citrus, avocado, apple, nut trees, things of that sort. However, when you are dealing with a short-lived plant, such as something between 50 to 100 days, their dominance is going to be bacterial. They're going to have a more bacterial rather than a fungal-dominated soil. Therefore, the ratio changes. Not that one is pure fungus and the other one is pure bacteria, but the fact that you now have a differing ratio that occurs between them. And so, having been on the receiving end, not just of the phone calls I know that Soilworks is getting in regards to this, but also having had a chance to talk to no-tillers, some of them are quite adamant about the fact that they need to protect the mycorrhizal fungi at all costs. And I asked them, are you raising crop plants or are you raising mycorrhizal fungi?
What if they say both?
I have not heard a good response, and that includes both right now, because both right now is maybe not quite understanding the role that they have, because usually if someone does mention both, I know that they are absolutely emphasizing the mycorrhizal fungi. They'll usually take care of themselves, and they do very well in a tree situation. However, we do need to speed up the process for the short-lived plants that are going for between 50 to 100 days. And so there is some benefit to putting down mycorrhizal fungi, but the ratio never gets that high in the short-lived plants. And so we are dealing with a bacterial-dominated system, and therefore breaking down the mycorrhizal fungi and trying to avoid doing that is placing the cart before the horse. It's emphasizing one over the other. We are now twisting something which is secondary and should be secondary, which are the mycorrhizal fungi, and making it the dominant part of the thinking that is now part of no-till agriculture. And I find this disturbing because now when I'm talking to them, they want to discuss mycorrhizal fungi because based upon the actions, I know that this is the main concern, and they will not want to have a good conversation about a BRIX refractometer. They're not discussing plants and soil as much as they should. Not because they can't, but because the emphasis has changed. Mycorrhizal fungi has moved to the top. And when we have this top-bottom, bottom-down approach, things are now topsy-turvy. There are going to be problems. And having measured some of the no-till crops, which of course are suffering from many ailments, they are low BRIX. I've not been horribly impressed with the no-till plants that have been tested. I want to make an exception right now for the strip-till. The strip-till does do better than the no-till, as far as I can tell. There is more oxygen in the soil and some more available nutrients. And anything that is in between is not as important. But I do want to make that distinction right now, so I don't want people to think I'm making a till comment, because it's not about till and not tilling. It's about just at least doing enough, at the very least. And so that's where we stand with the mycorrhizal fungi.
Question.
Please.
Mycorrhizal fungi are different than pathogenic, disease-causing, problematic fungi like Phytophthora, Rhizoctonia, Pythia.
They are different. So we are talking about different fungi. So because we're dealing with different fungi, if I were to spray, I don't know, a fungicide, would this kill the mycorrhizal fungi?
Wait a minute.
Take your time. Cue Jeopardy music right now.
Possibly.
Possibly, yes. Because fungicides are indiscriminate fungal killers. And so by putting down a fungicide, you're trying to take care of the fungal pathogen, which you may or may not have at that time. I say may or may not because you may have it, but you may not have it because some people put it down in order to prevent their crops from getting a fungal infection. So it's a premature go ahead.
Fungicides detrimental or beneficial to good soil aerobic microbes?
Okay, to good beneficial soil microbes, they are detrimental.
Okay.
But they are useful if we are dealing with compacted soil, not enough oxygen, the fungal pathogen starts to take over because we don't have that healthy ratio of aerobic to anaerobic bacteria, which usually should be in the 80 to 20 range. Once the anaerobic bacteria start to take over, as they often do in compacted soil, there are problems, and these problems are sometimes manifest through fungal infections.
The judge, I'm going to call this the judge.
That looks a lot like a refractometer, though. Are you sure
The evaluator.
The evaluator. Now it sounds like some movie.
If you have a low sugar content under 10,
yeah,
will you naturally grow a wonderful count of good, beneficial mycorrhizal fungi?
No, it will not be as good as you want it. The reason why is because mycorrhizal fungi require a significant amount of carbon, sugar, which means they're going to need to be fed by the plant in order to continue and subsist in the soil, usually in union with the roots and the rootlets of the plant. So if we are dealing with a low BRIX plant that is not able to shunt sugars down, this means, understandably, that the mycorrhizal fungi count is going to be lower. Also related to that, the microbial content will also be lower too. They all need sugar. We all need sugar to survive, okay? So because of that, these plants right now, if they are not giving as much sugar into the soil as possible, cannot possibly make the soil as healthy as it should be. And in order to get these microbes and mycorrhizal fungi, you need, sadly, a massive amount of sugar, more sugar than what is being put in by the plants today. Go ahead. You've got a thought. I could tell you've got that look on your face.
I've got a lot of them.
Okay, let's just start with the first one, okay?
Fine. Low sugar based on the BRIX of the plant.
Yes.
Actually checking the essence of that plant.
Yes.
If you're below 6 BRIX,
yes,
you probably don't have a great thriving number of beneficial aerobic mycorrhizal fungi.
Absolutely true.
What kind of fungus would you possibly be growing in a low sugar environment?
Okay. All of them can potentially grow in a low sugar environment. So
Phytophthora?
Any type of them. Yeah.
Rhizoctonia.
I have no idea what he's saying. These words are huge.
Pythium.
Is that a snake?
Verticillium wilt.
Wow. Do you know how many syllables he's
throwing out?
Powdery
white mildew.
Oh, wow. That's even multiple words right now.
Smut. Rust.
All right. Monosyllabic words. We're doing much better right now. Thank you for coming down to my level.
The scumbag problems enjoy low sugar.
Yes, they do.
Okay. So you had said in a different video, and I'd like to, if you would, repeat it in this one.
Okay.
Beneficial aerobic soil microbes. When some of these growers, please check your carbon to nitrogen ratio. You have to ask for, especially on your soil test. But if they have an 8-to-1 carbon and nitrogen, which is what most soil is, what can they expect for microbial activity and mycorrhizal activity at an 8-to-1 carbon and nitrogen?
And an 8-to-1, you're not going to have enough carbon in order to have what I would call a proliferation of the microbes, a proliferation of the fungi. The fungi need to be able to grow their hyphae, or sometimes called hyphae, depending upon whether you're from America or whether you're from Europe. I've got a Latin background, so I'm going to go with hyphae. I know some people are kind of freaking out right now, thinking, I still like to eat Sundays too. Not a big fan of Sundays, but anyways, I digress. Want to go back to this? The fact is that you need a high amount of sugar in order for the hyphae to grow, and for the bacteria in order to proliferate, which means to separate and make more. Not really babies is the word though, but they're simply splitting in a type of the binary way, and this is how reproduction is occurring. You cannot have this without energy, and the energy source is sugar. So therefore, you need a lot of sugar. 14 BRIX is a relatively safe zone. Don't get me wrong, I've measured many trees much, much higher than 14. But 14 is a good safe zone to be at in order to have a healthy population of microbes and a healthy population of fungi, including the mycorrhizal fungi that we were just discussing right now.
Okay, these microbes and beneficial fungi are air breathing. Yes or no?
The nitrogen-fixing bacteria are usually not air-breathing. The nitrogen-fixing bacteria are usually anaerobic. But most of the microbes that I was referring to, and I believe Mr. Rabenberg is referring to that 80-20 ratio.
He has to complicate everything.
I am complicating.
What we found is when we do pressure readings,
yep,
PSI, once we hit 300 PSI...
Ooh, that's bad.
Yeah. 300 PSI... A feeder root can't push through that.
Only a few plants can go through 300.
Yeah. Now, what we have found is a taproot of a weed, a thistle, Canada thistle, musk thistle, bull thistle, we've seen where they have penetrated up to 800 PSI. Here's my point. Just below 300, a feeder root can push through, but that feeder root is unprotected. There's a sergeant of arms that's supposed to colonize around that root.
Mm-hmm.
And if there's over 200 PSI, the microbes, I think, are union. And at 200 PSI, they're like, we cannot handle this kind of pressure. We're not working. We're done. We need more air. We want more oxygen. We want a little more space.
Yeah.
We're a little bit confined here. We feel just a little bit like you're not taking care of us.
But they're not getting it because they're pushing through that compaction zone, which let's just say for the sake of argument is at 300. So as it's pushing its way through, you're not going to get a lot of microbes that are colonizing that root, even if it is able to pass through it. And so because of that, you've got like a dead sort of naked root. This is still a family show. And because of that, you're not going to have the microbes necessary in order to help that root grow and actually get the nutrients that it needs.
Yes. This is why we travel with a penetrometer. This is why we're going to sound like a broken record, because every time we get a chance to talk, it doesn't matter what your type of farming is, we want it to be more efficient. We want it to be more cost effective.
Mm-hmm.
We want it to be more profitable for you. We don't hate the synthetic companies.
They have their place.
Yes. They're good to solve a problem. But let's correct the cause so you don't have to count on them.
So you don't have to depend upon them. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
So make sure you have surface tension that's proper, 100 to 150 PSI. A lot of these growers that contacted us that showed emotion on their...
some degree of emotion. Sure,
sure. They got a little chirpy.
Sure.
We appreciate that. Thank you. Please check to see how tight your soil is, because if you're over 200 or 300 PSI in your soil, do they have any mycorrhizal activity in that soil?
Very little to none at that point. By the time you get to 300, yeah, there's almost none. 200, I'm sure you could find traces of it only.
So if there's compaction,
mm-hmm.
there's minimal at
minimal
best.
Minimal at best.
If the sugar content is under 6 or 8?
There's almost not enough sugar going in there in order to proliferate all of the life activity that needs to be in the soil around the rhizosphere.
So when these guys say, Tom, Dr., Mr. PhD, the and sugar daddy of plants.
They say all of them.
And they will list all of those. It's like, I can't till because I'm worried about
killing
the mycorrhizal fungi.
Yeah, it brings a tear to your eye. I know.
I know you're an emotional guy.
Very emotional.
Check your numbers.
Mm-hmm.
Take a look to see where you're at. If you're no-till, if you're minimum-till, give me some thumbs here. Whatever your tillage is, we want it to work for you.
Oh, sorry. I was out of sync.
You always have to go past the point of common sense.
Totally messed up. Sorry, the timing was way off. I apologize.
The thing is, a refractometer, an EC meter, measures the heartbeat of the soil, so to speak, and a penetrometer will give you an idea of the environment that you've created with however you farmed. And you'll know where you're at. Because if you're going to take a journey to success, you need to know where to start.
Mm-hmm.
And you need to know what the first step is. So I'm Glenn with SoilWorks. This is Dr. Tom Dykstra. We appreciate your time. And if anybody wants more information on BRIX and sugar and all the good stuff that you've got as commander of carbon, oxygen, and hydrogen, where would they look?
They could take a look on YouTube. I got a few videos up on YouTube. Just type in Thomas Dykstra. They're going to come up pretty quick, and if you find yourself being, I don't know, an insomniac, I think watching the videos may actually cure you. You're welcome.
We appreciate the time. We hope this information has been beneficial and look forward to the opportunity of meeting you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Nice work.